Thanks very much, Mark, for the introduction, and I just want to extend my thanks to you again for inviting me here to the Centre for Agroecology, Water and Resilience. And it's a real pleasure for me to be here, actually, because I think out of sort of UK research institutions, I think here at CORE you're doing, in my view, some of the more cutting-edge research into agriculture development and ecological resilience. So it's a real pleasure to be here with you guys. Okay, so today's talk is basically made up of two parts, or really, I have sort of two goals in mind. So the first goal is to try and make some headway into this thing we call sovereignty, which I think is all too necessary given that it's pretty difficult to find any consciously organized form of peasant politics that isn't articulated through the broad philosophy of food sovereignty. So to get us stuck in, what is food sovereignty? All right, this is always a really difficult question to answer. But I think we can get a relatively good handle on the definition through the following pillars. So by and large, my reading is that the first pillar refers to rights, to the right to healthy food and the self-determination of producers. The second pair refers to territorial organizations, the local scale as a starting point, and self-governing control of productive territories. And then finally, the third pair, I think, refers more to knowledge and technique, which critically shapes the organization and execution of socio-productive activities. But these definitions, numerous as they are, never really tell us exactly who or what is sovereign in food sovereignty. And somewhat surprisingly, the academic literature on food sovereignty, which by now is at least three generations old, has never really had that much to say on sovereignty per se, but until now, that is. So the current generation of food sovereignty scholars have really finally started to put this concept into the crosshairs of critical analysis. And I think the virtue of this is that they do so not in the service of high theory, but as a way of properly grounding the complexities contemporary peasant politics. So the first goal of the talk is to give my own contribution to this burgeoning area of scholarship of what we could call the sovereignty problem in food sovereignty. So the second goal of the talk then is to try and capture and articulate the pretty fascinating but oftentimes mind-bogglingly complex process of food sovereignty that's taking place in contemporary Venezuela, in Bolivarian Venezuela. And I think one of the utilities of analyzing the sovereignty problem in this case is that it helps us to sort of cut across some of the complexities of peasant politics, particularly when these agents are calling for sovereignty within their own food systems. Now, the Venezuelan example is, by most accounts, one of the more radical examples of food sovereignty politics in the world today. And while scholars are clearly aware of the challenges facing Venezuela on the road to food sovereignty, I think the framework proposed here that I'm going to put forward helps to cut through some of the rhetoric and the plurality that we see in the Venezuelan case by placing greater emphasis on the sort of class relational character of agrarian transformation. So before we get stuck in, I'm just going to give you a little preview of what I'm going to be arguing. So what I want to put forward, basically, is a slightly different way of conceptualizing the concept of sovereignty in the context of food sovereignty studies. And as we'll see in a moment, one of the problems, or I suppose one of the challenges of contemporary scholarship on the sovereignty problem is that, in my view at least, it's just too unwieldy. Now, to some people, this may reflect a type of plurality or diversity and richness, and in actual fact, it does. But to my mind, this can sometimes be a hindrance rather than a virtue. And so my theoretical wager is that we need to bring a more parsimonious account of what sovereignty is at its most basic level. So from my perspective, it's the historically and socially specific combination of rights plus territory that produces the shadow of sovereignty. Or to put it a bit more precisely, and borrowing terminology from the Marxist philosopher Jacques Bidet, it's property power and knowledge power that congeals into a type of sovereign power. So in approaching the problem in this way, we're able to begin with a more manageable set of concepts, in this case social property rights and practices of territorial governance, but which organically produce more complex determinations that then goes into the more complex terrain of food sovereignty politics. So I'm going to take those analytical coordinates and apply them to the case of Venezuela so that we can get a better handle on the sort of complexity and contradictions involved within the project of food sovereignty over there. And again, I think the framework proposed in terms of this relationship between rights, territory, and sovereignty will hopefully help to go some way to bringing some clarity to the picture of Venezuela by focusing on this two-sided problem, the problem of land rights, the democratization of land rights, and the challenges of protagonistic political governance. Okay. So about a decade ago, Raj Patel noted a curious ambiguity in the politics of food sovereignty. And the way he put it is, to demand space for food sovereignty is to demand specific arrangements to govern territory and space. At the end of the day, the power of rights talk is that rights imply a particular burden on a specified entity, the state. In blowing apart the notion that the state has paramount authority, by pointing to the multivalent hierarchies of power and control that exist within the world food system, food sovereignty paradoxically displaces one sovereign, but remains silent about the others. Now, to me, what's especially curious about this quote is that while it is perhaps one of the most cited passages in all of the food sovereignty literature, its actual premises, or the connections between rights, territory, and sovereignty, have only just begun to be taken seriously by food sovereignty scholars. And here I'm thinking principally of the recent work of Amy Trauger, Alistair Isles and Maya Montenegro DeWitt, Antonio Roman Alcala, and Cristina Schiavoni. But within this recent literature, we can see that there's an awful lot of variation of how we might actually go about defining sovereignty. So just very briefly sort of capping this stuff, I would say that Trauger and Isles, Montenegro DeWitt proffer a more traditional sociological account of sovereignty's basis and function, while Roman Alcala and Schiavoni seem to attempt a more schematic reading based on issues of scale and space. But the real problem for me is that I don't see any sort of rhyme or reason for these schematics. So for instance, why do we start with scales, geography, or institutions? Or again, what is the relationship between the capacity to act authoritatively, ability to influence political and economic processes, and the right to participate? So sort of my reading of this scholarship is that it does provide us with very useful indexes of sovereign power, but it doesn't quite get the ingredients to gel. So what I want to do, therefore, is use this as kind of a springboard and bring a little bit more parsimony to the analysis by beginning with fewer fundamental components and then grounding them into a more universalist ontology, and then seeing how this interaction creates conditions for more complex determinations. So as Marx suggested in his quite early work, there is something that connects all people through all historical epochs, and that is the need to interact with nature in order to reproduce the physical conditions of the community. And reproduce the physical conditions of both individuals and the community itself, or as he put it, the task of being there alive. But beyond this condition, we soon find a huge variation throughout history in terms of how people actually organize the institutional basis of juridical ownership, real economic ownership, and possession of the means of production. And these institutions therefore congeal into what we might call social property rights. So it's through the structure of social property rights that we actually find the means through which specific classes gain the right to exploit labor or derive surplus labor from the direct producers. Now what's interesting is that already for Marx, it was within this relational class dynamic that, as he put it, we find the innermost secret, the hidden basis of the entire social edifice, and hence also the political form of the relationship of sovereignty and dependence. In short, the specific form of the state in each case. Now, unfortunately, there's been a lot of debate about this specific passage over whether or not we really can take the relations of production and draw a neat line to the form of the state. And for the purposes of this talk, we can sort of put that debate aside. Because I think the insight of this observation, I think the real insight of this statement is that it really sort of brings to light the fact that exploitation is ultimately a political conflict. And in that sense, exploiters enjoy a formal characteristic of sovereignty, while direct producers are subsumed under a relation of dependence. So this grounds the first premise for understanding the content of sovereignty, or the power to control and dispose of the means of life, including human bodies and labor. But the second element of sovereignty is that of territory. And this is not in the sense that property simply sits in territory. It's the idea that property is a territory in virtue of how it's governed politically. So, as Stuart Elvin notes, territory can be understood as a type of political technology. And this refers to a bundle of techniques that map, measure, catalog, manage, and discursively frame a specific material space. Now, under the capitalist epoch, political power and the power to dispose of the means of production are uniquely separated. And what we end up with is an image of the sovereign Leviathan guarding over the separated realm of the non-sovereign civil society. But in actual fact, this was always more of an imaginary than a reality. Indeed, as Joshua Barkin argues in his book, Corporate Sovereignty, modern sovereignty itself is really nothing other than a set of concrete practices that attempt to govern life by establishing and transgressing boundaries of law. Now, in this schema, we actually find again that sovereignty becomes fractured between both state and capital because of their shared participation in the exercise of biopolitical power. Now, the biopolitics of capital emerges as its own mode of government in relation to the ways in which everyday life becomes governed by the production and circulation of abstract and socially necessary value. The state, meanwhile, organizes the political technology of capitalist society through the establishment of market and property relations, the political domination of capital, and the codification of the social division of labor, which is articulated through a bundle of rights discourses. So the upshot of all of this then is that it's not simply the state that monopolizes sovereign power. Rather, it's the capacity to govern human bodies and their productive potentialities, or property power, in combination with specialized technical organization of these relations, or knowledge power, that produces the shadow of sovereignty. And both economic and political actors, both capitalists and state managers, partake in this privilege of sovereignty through the co-imbrication property power and knowledge power required, property power and knowledge power combine in both sets of actors, where on the one hand, capital owns the means of production and it monopolizes the intellectual labor required for their technical organization, while the state effectively owns the nation and condenses within itself the intellectual labor required to organize society. In turn, laborers and citizens become ultimately absolutely dependent upon capital and the state. So then, to sum up this sort of framework, I look at spaces of sovereignty as bundles of property rights and production relations commanding human labor that are simultaneously shaped by a set of organizational powers that stamp these relations with a political, legal, and technical character. Okay. So thank you for bearing with me through this relatively sort of complex unpacking of abstract ideas. Let me now try and bring this back to the realm of food sovereignty, which is the entire point of this whole framework. So on the back of this, the obvious question that we ask is, what then does sovereignty look like under food sovereignty? And here an early response to this question was actually Philip McMichael's notion of multiple sovereignties, a concept that was counterposed to the modern discourse of commodification and the singularity of state sovereignty. And for McMichael, multiple sovereignties, in contrast, pluralize spaces of power, but with a very specific social content. As he put it, this content refers to a substantive conception of rights, economies, and ecological relations that transgress the liberal conception of rights with the politics of collective rights. Now, these collective property rights ultimately point towards a decommodification of land, the democratization and socialization of the means of production, self-sufficiency in inputs or agroecology, and the establishment of protagonistic governance practices. So this radical form of food sovereignty therefore represents a concerted effort to break the biopolitical dependence of capital and the state through the assertion of what we could call the sovereignty of labor. And this radical approach, I think, is the real implicit social content to McMichael's notion of multiple sovereignties, even if he doesn't quite explicitly go into unpacking the parameters inside of this. So in other words, because sovereignty is already a multiplied terrain of power, because it's a multiplied terrain of power within the realm of social production, I don't think it's quite enough to simply make reference to competing sovereignties or sites of sovereignty. What I think we need to specify is the way in which this kind of multiplication of sovereignties must be grounded within spaces of democratically self-directed labor and cooperative territorial governance. And so, as a very final qualification, which will become relevant as the paper goes on, this view of sovereignty as a fragmented, contested terrain of political struggle ultimately implicates the state itself as an analogous strategic terrain of struggle. So as the Marxist philosopher Nikos Balanzas put it, the state is not an object or a subject in its own right, but it's rather an ensemble or condensation of class forces that are in fact spread throughout the fabric of society. Everything from the bureaucratic loci of the state to the extended field of the relations of production. And in this way, the struggle for food sovereignty will take place across a range of differential distances from the state's core bureaucracies. Everything from self-organized collectives to engagement with electoral institutions. So this is basically the organizing framework that I'm going to try and apply to the case of Venezuela. And the following case study is going to track the evolution of food sovereignty through exactly these parameters: the relative transformation in property rights and relations in production, the evolution of democratic territorial governance, and then the general balance of political forces seen throughout the strategic terrain of the Venezuelan state today. Okay, so jumping right in. So, in most accounts of Chavez's agrarian reform, it was the passing of the 2001 land law that marked the first big push for agrarian change. But this event was significantly marked by numerous class struggles in the countryside, which both preceded and came after the passing of this law. Now, land inequality in Venezuela has always engendered land invasions and occupations, and these struggles constantly challenge the political power of land and capital. But the struggle for land democratization in Venezuela also traversed the juridical branch of the state, as well as the countryside itself. And in 2002, the Venezuelan Supreme Court, which by then was still very closely allied to the old dominant classes in the countryside, blocked the most far-reaching aspects of the land reform, particularly pertaining to the Cartas Agrarias, that recognized the validity of land occupations even in the absence of a formal land title. Now, Chavez actually overcame this obstacle by simply reorganizing the structure of the Supreme Court itself in 2004. But from that moment on, land reform pushed more vigorously into the private sector through a wave of expropriations of mostly idle cattle ranch and latifundio, which were typically preceded by land occupations themselves. So I think these types of peasant struggles really bring to the fore the ways in which rights are nothing but really a conflict-ridden terrain, which in fact, of course, works in both directions, depending on the balance of class forces. And we can sort of appreciate this through the pushback that's been taking place against peasant mobilizations in the countryside. As I was told by one member of the Frente Campesino Revolucionario Ezequiel Zamora, over 300 peasants have been killed over the last decade, 100 from the Frente alone. And this relative power and autonomy of landed capital in Venezuela is given by its command over the means of production and means of violence. And I think this kind of strikes a really sharp resonance with what George Chicarella Mar calls his description of this class as sort of local petty sovereigns. But again, it doesn't mean that landowners in Venezuela are simply mini sovereign states. Rather, it's to point out the fact that landowner power is crucially interwoven with other modes of sovereign power, particularly that of the judiciary, local politicians, and local security forces. And so here again, sovereignty is complexly interwoven between property power and knowledge power. But while the question of land reform points towards issues of redistribution, it's not entirely clear what kind of labor relations are actually pursued by, or property relations are actually pursued by the diverse peasant movements in Venezuela today. So for one of Venezuela's biggest peasant unions, the Coordinadora Agraria Nacional Ezequiel Zamora, the pattern of individual land rights that are currently taking place through land reform actually goes against what they call communal property-based forms of agrarian development, referring to collective forms of ownership. From yet another angle, peasants from the Arquimiro Galvaldon collective argue that, in fact, family-owned non-commodified lands contain an imminent collective potential beyond that of fully commodified individual property. And interestingly, the agrarian sociologist Mina Argoal has shown that this latter view is actually supported by various examples across the world in which shows a greater longevity for autonomously chosen collective cooperative farming among many families rather than top-down collectivization. But nevertheless, despite the decommodified nature of land titling in Venezuela today, one of the contradictions that emerges here is that once peasants actually gain a piece of land, once they gain the ownership, there's suddenly a bit of a break on the momentum of political organization. And as I was told by, again, another member of the Frente Nacional, when peasants obtain land rights, they suddenly become unwilling to engage in further organizational pushes for new rights, new investments, and so on. As he put it in his words, after the struggle for land came our struggle for roads, health, education, schools, and so on. So there has been progress made in these areas, but there is a systemic prevalence of demobilization after land titles have been granted. And this is something that movements in Venezuela are currently trying to think through very, very deeply. Now, I want to move a little bit beyond these internal debates over the direction of social property relations and sort of take a step back and really look at where land reform has taken us to so far. Now, according to the latest agrarian census, which is unfortunately a decade old by now, but it's the best we have in this case, overall distribution didn't really change that much over the entire decade preceding. The changes that really stand out is that both small and large-scale farms have lost out in favor of more medium-sized farms, which can be anything from 20 to 1,000 hectares. Now, of course, large land holdings only lost about 900 units, comprising some 3 million hectares. Now, and conversely, small farms lost fewer hectares, 255,000, but this represents a staggering 80,000 units. So this effectively means that the overall weight of change has left large units relatively untouched, while small farmers lost out predominantly to medium-sized holdings, which increased by about 239,000 hectares. But more worryingly still, there's been a net loss of land of production to the tune of about 2.9 million hectares. So this somewhat underwhelming picture of land democratization in Venezuela indicates a relative consolidation of commercialized middle strata of the peasantry, which predominantly hinges on sort of petty capitalist production and the variable employment of wage labour, even in conjunction with their own family labour. And although data on the relative distribution of labour regimes, for instance, the prevalence of permanent wage labour, temporary wage labour, these kinds of metrics, although they're not currently available for Venezuela today, I think we can surmise from this picture that the prevalence of wage labour in general has probably not changed that much over the last couple of decades. So this all sits in striking contrast to the overall political orientation of Venezuela's peasant movements, which all share a striking similarity to the radical wing of food sovereignty movements. And indeed, as one member from the Frente noted, where other regions of La Vía Campesina are talking of agrarian reform, we are talking of agrarian revolution. That is to say, transforming everything, not just modifying one article of one law, but to make laws that permit the guaranteeing of what peasants actually suggest, promote, and do. So though certainly this is radical in its orientation, the sentiment also gestures towards a kind of cautious negotiation and strategic cooperation with the state apparatus in order to bring such a revolution about. And this then relates specifically to questions of territorial governance. So, in contrast to capitalist territoriality, which tends to be fragmented along a terrain of competing units of production, the political geography of Bolivarian Venezuela and the types of territory adequate to a substantial food sovereignty regime actually share a striking similarity with what David Harvey refers to as nested hierarchical arrangements, differentiated by relative competencies adequate to a given territorial space and knowledge power suitable to its execution. So in other words, state officials may know nothing about agricultural production, but at the same time, peasants may know nothing about fiscal policy. So there will have to be some kind of division of competencies between relatively cooperative parts of society and institutions and so on. So Venezuela's model of protagonistic democracy does mirror this model somewhat by seeking to decentralize decision-making power through a variety of spatial scales, from local parishes and municipalities up to communal councils, communes which are made of many communal councils, and then finally, in 2014, this type of vertical territoriality was extended to encompass what was called the Socialist Presidential Council of Peasants and Fishermen that would link local delegates to the executive branch of the state. But here again, even among these innovative territorial structures, we find there's quite a few tensions that persist. And without wanting to belabor the point too much, as one peasant leader remarked to me, though we might have a structure of a council, there may not be substantial participation, perhaps because there's some fear on behalf of the jefe or boss that power may be lost. So despite these innovations, this kind of socio-territorial infrastructure kind of fails to translate into a really solid foundation, precisely because elements of knowledge power continue to be overwhelmingly concentrated within the state apparatus itself. Now, it's not all doom and gloom, because to my mind, some of the most interesting developments in this area actually take place really on the fringes of the state's strategic terrain. And this comes about largely through self-directed autonomous constructions of popular political technologies. Now, in Venezuela, we have the construction of what they call political territorial corridors. And these spaces or networks approximate a more horizontal form of territorialization in the context of food sovereignty. And these corridors form sprawling autonomous networks of support, exchange, and organization with new forms of economic and social management taking place. And I think it's worth focusing briefly on one of the most innovative agrarian movements in Venezuela today. So the agrarian commune El Maizal was born in 2009 when Chavez expropriated about 2,000 acre latifundio with the promise of giving the lands to the commune for their collective production. But no sooner was the land expropriated, it found itself going into state hands. And soon after this, with its ownership under the Venezuelan Food Corporation, the comuneros were offered wage work from the state, similar to what they might find from a private latifundio. So years after years of frustration, they finally occupied the land and actually kicked out the state company, which wasn't actually doing particularly very much with the lands themselves. Now, soon enough after their takeover of the lands, they were able to establish collective and incredibly efficient production, largely in corn, but other crops as well. And through this efficiency of production, they've actually been able to develop their own investment funds into other areas of production, such as beef, dairy, and vegetables, all of which are distributed to members of the commune and other surrounding territories at affordable prices. So additionally, these funds are actually invested in local infrastructure, such as education, housing, road paving, and credit services for local farmers. Now, organizationally speaking, the commune seeks to actually break down the structures of unaccountability associated with state bureaucracies by maintaining totally transparent accounts. So as one communard noted, one of the biggest differences between organized communes or organized popular power is how we manage or use the resources that enter the El Maizal commune. Every resource that comes into the commune is checked and reviewed by popular power. The 22 communal councils control this process, and anyone who lives here can carry out an audit. And for me, more remarkably still, is the commune's ability to step into state sectors of the economy in order to rescue underperforming or abandoned means of production. So taking over 12 high-tech greenhouses in 2014 from the Venezuelan Food Corporation, the commune has now begun to bring these infrastructures back online as they continue their repairs. Later in 2017, El Maizal took over the near-abandoned Portinos del Alba processing plant, a bilateral company established by Cuba and Venezuela through the Alba TCP regional institution. Found in total organizational disarray, the commune actively cooperated with the Alba workforce in order to bring the plant back to capacity. And in pretty quick turnaround, they soon began distributing pork through the local committees for food distribution and production. So, to my mind, it would be pretty fair to say that the El Maizal commune is perhaps the closest example we have to a fully-fledged radical food sovereignty regime, comprising cooperative relations of production that yield high levels of productivity, sophisticated territorial governance cascading through spaces of nested hierarchies, and the combined vectors of property power and knowledge power that function through democratically self-directed labor and cooperative governance. Now, as inspiring as this example is, and other examples like it, because it's certainly not the only commune in Venezuela to be doing these kinds of things, these examples nevertheless remain islands within an expansive sea of social contradictions. So we're going to take a step back a little bit and get a more sort of macro perspective of this whole thing. And so far we've seen how transformations in property power and knowledge power adequate to a substantial food sovereignty regime have been relatively hampered in Venezuela by a lack of real land reform and the prevalence of wage labor in the countryside on one hand, and the relative disorganization of the popular classes with respect to their active cooperation with state agencies. And again, the example of El Maizal is an exception to the rule. But I think if we look at the recent political struggles within and beyond this commune, we start to really get a sense of the overbearing, in my view, the overbearing power of the Venezuelan state today. So one of El Maizal's leading figures, Angel Prado, which is seen on the left here, he was recently denied permission from the country's National Electoral Commission to register his candidacy for mayoral elections in November 2017, with no apparent reason provided by state authorities, despite the fact that over 7,000 signatures were collected from within the community, which is far more than what is needed for the electoral rules required for registration. Now, with constant protest by the El Maizal commune against this decision, their appeal has been finally accepted by the National Electoral Council and is currently under review. And there's a lot more going into this story and so on, but again, I think this event really illustrates the ways in which, it illustrates two things. Firstly, the ways in which peasants wage their struggle across the entire strategic field of the state, from spaces of production to spaces of representative democracy. But it illustrates a second aspect as well, and to my mind, it sort of refers to what Nikos Polansis called authoritarian statism, which is ultimately characterized by the relative strengthening of executive power within the state apparatus at the expense of traditional modes of electoral democracy. Now, given that the PSUB, which is the reigning party, the dominant party, the Maduro's party, no? Given that the PSUB and the executive branch are so tightly fused, and in light of the fact that the government has recently made quite a few overtures to the private sector in order to get the economy kick-started again, I think it's not that much of a mystery of why groups like El Maizal should be looked at with such suspicion. But then we need to ask, if this is an authoritarian status regime, what is the material basis of it, or where did it come from? And for Polansis, this specific state form is always sort of expressive of a basic crisis of accumulation that fundamentally affects the state's legitimation capacity. Now, if we read it in that sense, the Venezuelan state has experienced this type of state form previously, particularly with Andrés Pérez's failed modernization drive in the 1970s. But with Chávez and later Maduro, we find a really unique form of authoritarian statism, insofar as we find the traditional concentration within the executive branch of the state, but it's been coupled, paradoxically, with a substantial push into decentralized protagonistic democracy at the same time. Now, the binding force between these two extremes of consolidated power within the state and a sort of decentralization throughout its strategic terrain, these two ends of the chain have always been sort of linked through the circulation of oil rents and the relative dominance of the oil sector within the economy. And because of this dominance of oil rents, the overvaluation of the national currency, the bolivar, has always favored cheap food imports over the long-term and more expensive project of actually building up endogenous production capacity. Now, the legacy of this accumulation regime is of central importance to explaining both the current crisis of the Venezuelan state and the current challenges facing food sovereignty initiatives. So, if we look at this group of staple foods, and actually these foods more or less go into sort of the national dish of Venezuela, pabellón, which is basically sort of made up of rice, yuca, plantain, beef, you know, and some grated cheese just for a good measure on top. Lovely dish, by the way, I absolutely love it. But if we just use this as a proxy for the Venezuelan diet, what we sort of notice is that yuca, plantain, and beef are effectively sort of flat. Rice production has not increased that much, and corn has certainly seen the biggest rise, but it's a relatively modest rise. Now, the problem then is that when we compare this to population growth, which is a pretty usual and average population distribution over a long period of time, we can see that per capita, there's just been less and less food over this period. Now, immediately a qualification is needed, because even though we're all pretty used to seeing these news stories of Venezuelans in long lines, sort of queuing for hours to find basic goods, usually these lines are for sort of strategic products, things like milk or meat in particular, cooking oil, for instance. The converse of that is that the usual sort of gamut of vegetables and fruits are in fact available on the shelves, much more so than these strategic products. But that's not the problem. The problem is that even though they're available on the shelves, they may not necessarily be available to consumers. And so when we look at this slide, what we can see is that between this range, between 2014 and 17, less and less families are actually able to purchase basic goods. So flour, meat, vegetables, milk, and fruit have all dramatically fallen over the last few years. And looking a bit closer, we can actually see that people have then begun to substitute legumes and starchy tubers, particularly yuca, as kind of substitutes for what they can't find. But then this, of course, leads to sort of monodietary squeeze, which is not necessarily a good thing for one's health over the long run. And so what's the reason for this massive compression of purchasing power? Well, basically it's because the state is trying to monetize its fiscal debt. Or in other words, it's basically addicted to printing money. So these fiscal measures are fed by several determinations, all of which no scholar, I think, can really figure out where it begins. It's really a vicious circle. And this circle comprises of, firstly, speculation in the black market for dollars, which is really the only store of value in the country. And speculation for other consumer goods, so, you know, as soon as you find some milk, instead of buying a normal amount, you'll buy as much as you can get, and then you'll hoard it, and maybe sell it on for a little profit. You add that up to the whole of society, and suddenly you get a very paradoxical picture here. So this is one element. Another element is that the government, understandably, is trying to alleviate this problem by raising the minimum wage. But it's raised the minimum wage 21 times since 2013. And so the minimum wage in Venezuela, the nominal wage, is basically 1.3 million bolivars, or about $6 at the black market exchange rate. So the massive difference between the rate of inflation and the rate of nominal wage increases has ultimately led to an increase in income poverty, with the sort of top section as extreme poverty and the bottom as just non-extreme poverty. But again, we can appreciate the sort of the differentials going up over the last 3 years when the crisis has really been setting in. So this therefore all comes together in a pretty depressing picture in which undernourishment has now really seen a comeback. And when you kind of compare it to the last available time when it was this high, it's really unfortunate that all of this decade's achievements have more or less been wiped out, which is a real shame for many obvious reasons, but it's a pretty dramatic picture. So the reason I wanted to mention all of this is these socioeconomic processes obviously point towards a major crisis for the Bolivarian state, at least in terms of basically producing a series of policies that are quite representative of a state apparatus that is just incredibly insulated and just constantly tries to seek its way out by systematically disorganizing popular classes on one side and simply printing its way out of the problem on the other. And in fact, as one of the leading Venezuelan peasant movements in the country noted, the Corriente Revolucionaria Bolivar y Zamora, as they put it, it's no secret that macro politics have become distant from the politics of the day-to-day, or from the politics of the people. The official discourse no longer registers in the language of the commons. So if we understand the social content of food sovereignty as fundamentally underwritten by the democratization of property power and knowledge power, or in other words, the reunification of the labor process executed cooperatively through communal forms of territorial governance, then it seems as if Venezuela may in fact require a second Bolivarian revolution, if not for the sake of grounding the language of the commons into the material plane of food sovereignty itself. Okay, so let me just try and briefly conclude what we've covered today. First thing I want to do is to just sort of resituate where I think this contribution is in terms of contemporary food sovereignty studies. the four scholars that we briefly encountered, I do think that they each provide really stimulating insights into the nature and function of sovereignty in the context of food sovereignty struggles. And despite my comradely critique of these approaches, there is one thing on which we all absolutely agree. The fact that sovereign powers are more diffuse and more contested than we're traditionally used to thinking. And again, I think actually the work of Amy Trowbridge shares striking similarity to my own research interests, particularly in terms of focusing on what she calls territory, economy, and power, in terms of problematizing the liberal capitalist state. My goal, in conjunction with all this, was to simply try and bring a little bit more clarity to the analysis by just starting with fewer components and seeing where the successive incorporation of those components could possibly take us in terms of an empirical analysis of a given case. So in this way, beginning with social property rights and territorial practices, or the related dynamics of property power and knowledge power, we could potentially go further still and try to understand how other determinations like legitimacy, ideology, or hegemony, how these inhere in the political economy of food sovereignty, or even how rights and territory can be thought about through different spatial scales. And these are definitely questions that I'm going to need to answer later on as I develop this framework further. But I do think that the strategic starting point for any food sovereignty project ultimately rests on a successful class struggle on the land, with the formation of popular knowledge grounded in agroecological practice and the formation of democratically organized territorial modes of production. Now, to be sure, these are no small feats, but they are imminently necessary for a genuine food sovereignty regime. So in relation to the case study of Venezuela, which arguably embodies some of the most concerted efforts on behalf of both state and societal actors, we need to look far more closely at the actual transformations taking place in the realm of property rights, relations of production, and territorial governance. So firstly, peasant struggles on the land continuously transgress the boundaries of law, and in the process reveal the variegated terrain between de facto and de jure property rights. So in essence, again quoting Barkan, these types of peasant struggles engender concrete practices that attempt to govern life by establishing and transgressing the boundaries of law. But, as we've seen from the latest agrarian census, there's a little overall change in the patterns of landholding. If anything, there's been much more of a promotion of a middle strata of rich peasants that continue to rely on wage labor. Secondly, the emergence of protagonistic democracy at different territorial scales certainly converges somewhat with the notion of multiple sovereignties that I've been unpacking here. But again, we know that there's a great deal of tension in terms of the cooperative relations between actors on the ground and other elites that occupy different parts of the state apparatus. And then lastly, there's the specific political economy of Bolivarian Venezuela, particularly the dominance of oil production and the contingent effects this has on monetary conditions. And all of this places enormous strain on the struggle for food sovereignty in the country. In other words, every victory on the land among the peasant classes and every achievement in the construction of popular political technologies constantly runs into the iron cage of oil rent circulation, inflationary pressures, and irrational practice of hoarding and speculation within the entire economy. So the present reality of food sovereignty in Venezuela is therefore one in which the insurgency of popular struggles does reformulate the multiplied sovereignties of capital and state power, but it nevertheless remains ensnared by the concentration of property power and knowledge power in a society that paradoxically adheres to the principles of socialism in the 21st century. And I'll leave it there. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.